especially with everything going on. But we have special guests, our special guests here today from Art Opportunity Knox. Chris and Tywoods. Michelle, why don't you come on up and talk a little bit?
Talking to the camera.
Yes, and to the camera. Hey, camera.
Yeah, but where's the bar?
People that's joining us online.
Oh, my goodness. Look. Okay, well, hello. Hello, joining us online. Welcome to Linked Up, the Artist Linked Up. This is our first official.
This is our first official meeting, our last meeting.
Year.
So we had our first real meeting when we actually had gigs that day. So we're actually, yes, this is actually, you know, our group is for actors, entertainers, and aspiring actors and entertainers. But today's information is going to be even so much more than that.
For writers, producers, anyone in the performing arts industry. So if you know that you're moving into the ATL, you're trying to figure out how to get plugged in, how to get started, then, you know, as independent artists, we're always like, okay, where is the money going to come from to fund our projects? Well, this guy, okay, Chris Woods, and then his wife Ty Woods, they have some amazing information they're gonna share with us today. So we want you guys to stay plugged in. Go ahead and tweet. What else do we do? We tweet,
hashtag.
Y'all know how we do in the social media world. You can always stream online, but those people who are staying
home,
all that kind of stuff, go ahead and stream online, share. Hashtag, do what you need to do, because this is amazing information coming at you.
Awesome. So definitely, hashtag Linked Up Church. It's an honor for us to be here. My name is Chris Woods.
And I'm Ty Woods.
And we do something that's called Love and Entrepreneurship. We have an online platform we use, which is Facebook Live, where we actually talk about business, and we talk about entrepreneurship, and we talk about love, and how we're able to actually kind of work together. Most people have a hard time working with their spouses sometimes.
I still have a hard time sometimes. But it's a blessing to be alongside with my partner in life and to be able to do what God has called us to do in this space called business and arts and entertainment world. And so I am excited to share about the information that we have today. I could not possibly put everything that I know in an hour and 15 minutes.
Yeah.
So I'm going to give you the nuts and bolts, and then I'm going to give you my information, because you can always call me or email me and ask questions. Because I know that Chris and I, we tried looking up all this information in the beginning when we first started, and it was just such an overwhelming amount of information. We were just so overwhelmed, and it took years for us to start raising money. I know some people ask, like, how does, you know, what is your credibility in this space? Well, I'm glad you asked. So our purpose, though, first of all, our purpose is to expose creatives to creative funding strategies in an effort to provide financial support within your artistic field. So this is not just for the filmmaker or the music producer or musician, the actor. This is for also the graphic designer, for the visual artist, for anybody who is in a creative field that they feel like is going to lead to this starving artist thing that they tell me about.
Exactly.
So we're not just talking about strategies that can be used in creative field. We're talking about strategies that also can be used in business and nonprofit. So just know that this could transfer across the board. Now, who are we? So I'm Ty Woods. I am I have an MBA from Post College of Business. So I have been traveling the country for over 10 years doing workshops sort of like this. I am an entrepreneur. I've been a full-time entrepreneur now for about eight years. And I have companies that I run, but one in particular is a nonprofit called Opportunity Knox. You may have heard of it. It's a leading arts and entertainment organization in the state of Georgia. to underprivileged youth. Another aspect of what I do is I raise money for other organizations. So over the course of a few years that I've been raising money, I've raised a little over $4 million, and I continue to raise money every year. This year, I'm estimated to raise a little over $1 million, just not for my organization, but for other organizations. So I am extremely excited about showing you how to raise money. I have tools.
So the slide here is a little bit about how we flow together. So of course you talked about a little over 10 years ago we started a nonprofit called Opportunity Knocks, which provide arts for underprivileged students. And so at this event, anybody know anything about gaming?
Esport?
No, actually.
What?
Okay, Mark.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're actually at this 11 Rain where we're actually, our organization is looking to get into e-gaming and e-sports, right? And so we a part of what we do is we're very creative in our approach in what we do. So that means that we got to be ahead of whatever's happening. So this is us at an event. But then here is our oldest.
He is a senior in high school right now. He plays football. He's a running back. He just got accepted into Albany State University.
So,
we are excited about that he is leaving. I mean, that he's going to college. Oh, did I say that out loud? We are excited about him graduating. And then we also have a 5-year-old who is so cute. His name is DeLorean, and he's standing in front of a DeLorean. And he is such an amazing child. And this is us. This is us. So this is kind of like an interactive workshop. We are going to do some lecture style when I get into the actual meat of it. But I also want to know who's in the room. I like to know what it is that you do. And what would you like to get out of this workshop today? So since we have a pretty small, relatively small class, we have an opportunity to go through this exercise. So if you could tell me what's your name, what, if you're in the field of arts, you can tell me your field of arts, but if you're not, then you just tell me what your business or nonprofit is, and what do you want to get out of today?
All right, so here's the rule, though. It got to be 30 seconds. So
yes.
Like, hey, my name is such
and such.
Because I know you can get deep, boy. I do this, come on,
especially
as creative. You do multiple things, right? Just
like that. You start telling them what happened.
Where we look at creating content for, you know, all the different genres. I'm currently producing a one-woman stage play, which I hope for it to be, you know, April 4th, if, you know, everything goes well with everything that's going around. So what I'm hoping to get out of today is to really be able to learn more about funding some of these projects and just to really gain some insight from your experience.
Christina Hammond. I am an entertainer, so I sing, act, model, and do a lot of other creative things, creating stuff, raising children. It's a great and what I hope to get out today is pretty much understand about funding and things, because there are some things that I am supposed to do, but because I don't have funding, I haven't really gotten all of the pieces together.
I'm Karen Dully, I'm Lamar's wife, so I'm assisting him. But also, just in, you know, as far as myself, I would like to eventually get into food safety consulting. And I'm in public health right now, and it's about time for me to go ahead and step into the next level as to what I'm supposed to do. And so, the best part of that, public health for me, is the educational part. So, I want to see how I can get into setting up different ways of getting
Well, yeah. Hey, everybody. Good morning. Good afternoon. Now, I'm Michelle Elliott, and I've been doing Chris and Tiger for a long time, and Lamar and Karen Gully. So I just go way back with the church that we were a part of before Faith Christian Center, and it has evolved into this wonderful place with Pastor Gregory. And I'm an actor, writer, and then a director, also an aspiring producer. So with the play that I just directed, that was done at Port of San Bernardino Valentine's Day play, I'm very interested in getting more information about funding, because this is where we were, yes, getting information about funding.
And the reason why we do that is because a lot of times our connections are right in the room, they're right in the places that we go, we run across people, and don't realize that they might be the missing puzzle to what we currently need. So partnerships is definitely how we have grown and developed. Yeah, so, and then part of that, we have to, everybody in the room, no matter if you're an artist or not, you have to have an entrepreneurial mindset. And so when you look at this picture, what are some things that pop out to you about this image here? You can shout them out.
Start small,
okay.
Continue growing.
I like that.
The light bulb.
Nurturing.
The light bulb, the ideas. Growing bigger.
Yeah, I like that. What did you say, Michelle?
Oh, the light bulb.
Yep, the light bulb. Yeah. So
it takes work to feed your growth.
Ooh, I like that. It takes work to feed your growth. You know, as I look at it, I see different stages of development. And within those developments, if you notice, there are branches, there are leaves that are connected to that. And as you continue to birth this and grow that idea, you'll find that idea can birth other ideas and create new revenue strategies. Because that's a part of what we're here to talk about, is how am I going to generate these revenue strategies to be able to perform and fund my ideas, right? So being an entrepreneur, that's what we're doing. It's living a few years of your life like most people won't, so that you can spend the time for the rest of your life like most people can. And that's what we have done. We've sacrificed so much in the beginning, and people don't know about us being repo, homeless, walking to the bus stop. People don't see that, and then they see the development. So there's gonna be some sacrifices. Some of you all at the stage, like, I'm sacrificing now. I'm telling you right now, just be encouraged, because you can get there, right? Because the biggest mistake is a small business can make is thinking like a small business. So don't think that your idea is small. Don't think that yourself to be small, right? Because it can develop into something larger. Can I accept failure? I can't accept not trying. This is Michael Jordan. I can accept failure, but I cannot accept not trying. So tell me I can't, then watch me work twice as hard to prove I can. So what are some I can'ts? Things that we tell ourselves. What are some things that we tell ourselves? Go ahead, shout them out. We like interaction.
I can't get started because I don't got no money.
I can't get started because I don't have no money. Yep, that's a good one. That's a big one. What are some other things?
I can't do it because I don't know nobody.
I like that one. I can't do it because I don't know nobody. I don't have the right team. I don't have the right partnerships, right?
I don't have the knowledge. I can't because I don't have the knowledge.
I don't have the right knowledge. Yep, that's a good one. That can stop us right there. We can fear that maybe I don't know enough.
I used to say I can't because I was too big.
That's good. Self-image. Mm-hmm. Sometimes self-image can stop us in the ways.
Or time. I've just some of the people busy. They're busy moms.
I can't
busy.
Like,
I can't.
Yeah,
I
time.
Have
time. I like
time
that.
My kids.
I don't have time to start kids.
Is. Yeah.
Or the tools or resources.
Say that one more time.
The tools or resources.
I don't have like tools or resources. I like that one. So these are the things that as entrepreneurs that we have to keep in mind is our performance. When we work hard, I heard somebody talk about that earlier. See, the part of performing is actually applying the right work and the right effort. Because we can be working, but we're not working in the right direction. And a part of that is keeping our attitude, our behavior, our action that's going to cross that solution to produce the result. If you notice, our mindset is a cycle. And this should be the cycle that we're on. Because every idea, we're going to have to go through the same process.
Perfect example, you ever went to the gym and you continue going to the gym and you didn't see results while you were going to the gym, and then you get trainer, and next thing you know, like a week later, you lost like 3 inches around. You're like, wait a minute, what happened? He said, well, because you weren't applying the right amount of effort in the right way. So you may be doing weights, but you're not doing weights the correct way. So it's the same thing with performance. The reason why you're not moving further ahead in this field is because you're not doing it the right way. So that's what we're here to help you adjust your mindset. Of course, it's all about attitude. If you think that you can't, then you are right. You can't. But first thing we gotta do is get this mind right. And then you'll start seeing results.
So I like this image here. It says, on the road to success, there are no shortcuts. And we see this Mack truck trying to take this shortcut, right? In the, if you look at the back, it says, our most valuable resource sits 63 feet ahead of us. We are our most valuable resource. And we got to realize that even when we're trying to do, there is no shortcuts. It's going to take hard work. It's going to take the right connection to build.
Anybody ever heard this saying?
We'll work for food. Starving artists, right?
Starving artists. So we always hear that word. We've been hearing it for years, decades. And one of the things that artists have, the creatives have started doing is accepting that it is okay for us to starve. It's okay for us to be broke as long as we are following our passion. Mm-hmm. And that is absolutely a lie from the devil. You don't have to be a starving artist.
So it takes the education that you talked about. It takes us renewing our mind. It takes us thinking from an entrepreneurial mindset. And some artists have a hard time changing that. And that's why they become starving artists. Because they don't understand the work and the efforts and strategy that it takes.
So we're going to jump right into the meat of what we're going to talk about today. So we wanted to lay the foundation first, talk about our mindset. Because in order for us to get to the second part of what we're going to talk about, if we don't adjust our mindset, then sometimes it's not going to be a one-time fix. It's a renewing. The Bible talks about renewing the mind. That's an ongoing process, a daily process. Even I started a weight loss journey, but really it's a health journey in October. And since I lost 42 pounds, I just checked in yesterday at the doctor's office. And I'm going to say, oh, you can talk about that. To lose weight, and I always get to about 18 to 20 pounds, and then I stop, and I go right back into it. So this is the most I've ever lost, and I believe that this is the final time that I will have to diet. This time, this is a lifestyle.
Wow.
And it all started when I made a choice to start here, and renewing my mind, and reading books, and daily meditating on, you know, when God says renew your mind and meditate on the word day and night, it's whatever area you are struggling in, that concept, that principle actually applies to that, especially if you're struggling with weight. So I have strongly advised you, whatever area you feel like you're struggling in the most, take that and engulf yourself with knowledge, with revelation. God will give you revelation. But once you start seeking the knowledge regarding it, it's just going to become easier and easier and easier and easier. So that's what I did when I first started looking into becoming a development person, because I was really a good writer. And when I started writing grants and sort of started winning these grants, I was like, wait a minute, I got a niche here. And it really wasn't about how great I write. It was about how the content made sense to that particular funder. So we're going to talk about the multiple streams of income that you can have as a creative. So we're not just talking about one area. I wish I would have brought my income statement. We did, our accountant just turned in my 2019 income statement for all of my businesses, and I wish you could see the line item under income. It's about 8 different streams. And so that's That comes from this principle right here, and I can promise you, you probably have spread over and over and over again.
You skip right on through it.
And this is going to change your life. Okay, so Genesis 2:7, this is not meant to be a Bible study, but this is who we are. But in Genesis 2:7, it says, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. The Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he formed. And out of the ground the Lord God made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil." Peep this out. "Now a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it parted and became four," everybody say, "four riverheads."
Four riverheads.
"The name of the first is Pishon. It is the one which skirts the whole land of Havilah, which there is gold." Everybody say, "There's gold." "And the gold of that land is good." So does that mean that gold can be bad? Okay, let's keep reading. Delium and the onyx, this is the second river. The onyx are there. So in Delium, the onyx stones are there. Everybody say onyx stones. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one which goes around the whole land of Cush.
Y'all heard about that, huh?
The name of the third river is Hadikio, and it is the one which goes towards the east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the river Euphrates. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it.
Yep. And it's so much meat in there. But if you notice in the beginning, you see God formed man. And then at the end of the verse, then God took man and he placed him in there. But notice there was a plan. God had already created the streams of revenue in order for Adam to be able to be sustained. And so a lot of times what we do is we have these great ideas and we skip the middle part. We automatically want to be planted in there to be able to keep this idea that God gave us. But there's times where we have to sit and begin to strategize, begin to divide what these streams are in order for us to be able to provide for ourselves and so that we can be able to be kept.
So you notice, you're right on it.
It's so much more I can teach you.
It's so much. But if God had four streams,
come on now.
Why you only got one job?
Why you just got your job?
Okay, and he didn't even put man in there until the provision was already there. The provision was already there.
Right, so a lot of times what we do is we begin to create these ideas and then we say, all right, Lord, bless it. But then we ask God to bless it before we actually begin to walk into it.
Right, honestly, if it's where God wants you to be, the provision is already there. That is the point of this.
Right.
The provision is already there. He will put you there in the place where provision is. You just have to look around and see where it is. You are already in the midst of provision. So that leads me to the next scripture. Ecclesiastes 11:2. I saw this and it blew my mind. This is the NLT version. But this, it translates in all cross versions. This is amazing. He says, invest in seven ventures.
You say seven.
Yes, in eight. You do not know what disaster may come upon the land. And actually, if you go to this book, Ecclesiastes chapter 11, and read the first 10 verses, that whole, well, not the whole chapter, but at least the first 10 verses, relates to what God's plan is for you to invest, how you're supposed to invest your time and money. So we don't have time to go deep into this. If we had a conference, we could go deep into this. But
we're still talking about multiple streams.
So first thing you want to know, how do I find my stream? So the first thing we ask you is, what are you good at? So two of the streams, notice two of the streams, God already had provision that. Gold and onyx, right? So these are supernatural streams that God will place in your life. The other two didn't have natural resources. You want to know where those other two are? In you.
It was already there.
It was already in Adam. What did he tell Adam when he put him in the garden? He told him to tend it and to keep it. Those are two different fields.
Which also meant that God already put the ability in him to be able to do what he needed to do.
Right. So what are you good at? So we'll just start to throw it out there. What are you good at? You tell me what you good at. Throw it out there. Some of you guys.
I'm good at running my mouth.
That's a gift for the time.
You got a gift to get.
Right.
Okay.
Teaching.
That's good.
Writing.
Yep.
And coming up
with creative ideas. So you write and you speak it.
Come on. What are you good at? What are you good at? Sometimes you
process.
Sit and think about this. Processes?
Creating processes.
Creating processes.
That's good.
Ooh. Definitely need that. That's me too. I'm a process creator.
And so while you're thinking about someone probably like, man, I ain't really think about what I'm good at, right? Or I don't know what I'm good at, right? So you might want to take time out this upcoming week. Some, of course, because of coronavirus, a lot of stuff is shut down, so you got nothing but time, right? So you start writing down things that you're good at, and then from that checklist, decide what can you do that people will pay you for. I recently wrote a book, and you know, I'll share the information with you all a little later. It's called The Compact Guide to Creating Multiple Streams of Income. And in that book, I talk about utilizing what you already have, the provisions and gifts and time that you already have, creating that and making money from that.
So the concept we got that from, of course, we know about the widow woman, Elijah. He went to her and said, she said, I'm about to die, basically. I'm about to die. Me and my son, we're just going to eat this. He said, what do you have in your house? She said, nothing but a butter oil and some basically some pancake mix. And he said, you know what? Here's the plan. Go to your neighbors, borrow some drawers. Mm-hmm. And he gave her the plan. Mm-hmm. Now, I can't go there. We can get deeper into that. All right. So what is the first method that I would say is my top way? If you are a writer, the number one way you will get more money for your venture is through contracts and grants. Because this is based on following the protocol in the grant or the RFP. RFP means request for proposals.
Say that one more time.
Request for proposals. Sometimes it's called an RFQ, which is a request for quotes. If you see a RFP or RFQ that is related to your field, all you need to do is be a good writer. As long as you meet the criteria, the minimum criteria of this particular RFP, and you have everything in place. For example, I just completed a contract, actually. I try not to think about
it.
So they have deadlines for RFPs, and they are time deadlines. Usually it's 5 p.m. such and such day. So I was working on this contract, and they gave us the information 4 days before we needed to submit it. And I was so busy with all of this, you know, coronavirus stuff, and we manage after school programs, so you can imagine whatever the schools were going through, we were going through too. So I'm like, man, I don't have time to work on this contract. So I did it at the last minute on the day it was due. And I spent 6 hours writing up this contract. And my teenage son came in, what are we going for dinner? What are we? And he just started distracting me. And I got so distracted, I started talking to him. And next thing you know, it was 4:58 p.m. All I had to do was hit send. I was already done. But he distracted me from sending it, and I sent it at 5 o'clock from my side. Mm-hmm. she received it at 501 and declined to review the contract because it was sent, it was received at 501. This just happened this week.
Wow.
That was a $25,000 contract.
Now they really stick, they're sticklers.
Stickler.
Following those deadlines. However, we a lot of times work in favor, so, you know, yeah. So probably that's gonna come back. That's a whole other story.
Well, I'll tell you about the favor of God. When you are walking in your purpose and God's hand is on your life,
yeah.
He will open the doors that no man can open and no man can close.
Yeah. Well, we honestly,
we have contracts that we didn't even want to apply.
Yeah, we honestly believe what's for us is for us. And there's things that is for you that only you can be able to supply. And if you keep that attitude, don't worry about how it looks like. As long as you're doing your assignment, the provision will be there.
Yeah. So for me, contracts is the number one way that I make money for the organization that that I founded, and also money for other people. So if you are a writer, I would get with me because I'm a writer too, and we can work on some contracts. Grants are a little bit different. Grants are under nonprofit organizations. Anybody here have a nonprofit? Okay, perfect. Because you don't have to be a nonprofit in order to go after a grant. You do need to be, you don't have to be a nonprofit. A lot of times you think that you can't apply for something because you're not a nonprofit. All you need is a nonprofit to back you.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
It's called a fiscal sponsor. Mm-hmm. A fiscal sponsor. So guess what? There's only a handful of fiscal sponsors in the state of Georgia.
And who do you think is one?
I think is one. Yes, you are looking at one of the five fiscal sponsors that's representing the state of Georgia. So we have the ability to not only, now we don't write your grants, you will have to write your own grants or do your own event fundraising, but we will receive the funds for you. We will send out the thank you letters to your donors. We will track the donations for you. And we will make sure that you get 90% of that money back. Now 10% goes to the organization for administrative costs.
Right. So also keep in mind too, if whatever your idea or your proposal is, it has to be connected to the mission of the organization.
Right. So I can't do a fiscal sponsor if you are an animal rescue organization.
There's just no way we can tie that.
I can't tie that to my vision.
Yep.
I can't tie it in. But if you are looking to, you have a grant for a film project, a music project, anything creative, graphic design.
Right. You might have a film project that you're working on and you're like, you know what, I want to be able to utilize this to bring in young students to teach them so then they can start giving back. Well, guess what? That's directly connected to what we're currently doing.
Right.
You get the funds and you also put yourself in a position to give back.
Okay, take your phones out. I'm gonna take a picture of.
I'm sure they've been doing that all day.
This slide. Okay, so here's a couple of contracts that are coming out. Fulton County has contracts for the arts, and you don't necessarily have to be a nonprofit organization to apply for this. There are also organizations like ours who contract for services. We contract every single type of creative service that you can think of, we have contracted. Michelle, she is a current contractor for us for drama and acting. And she teaches all of our drama classes for us. And her there's a counterpart that she works along with who does film. He's actually an actor and a videographer, but in his capacity with us, he teaches our videography class, and him and Michelle teaches TV acting.
TV Kids.
So, right, TV Kids, that's the name of the program, it's called TV Kids. So, they teach kids how to act for television.
Right.
Because there's a difference when you're acting on stage.
And TV, two different postures.
Right. two different types of acting. So, we do contract, so if you're definitely looking for contract work, you can take one of our cards. And then register with Team Georgia Marketplace, because you can put in your field, the field of study that you're in, and anytime any government entity, I can tell you right now, somebody will think, well, what would a government, like a county government, a city government, even the state of Georgia, why would they need a creative? I can tell you right now, there is a contract right now open for a DJ.
Looking for a DJ. Yep.
For a DJ. If you know a DJ.
She sent it to me and was like,
I said, why don't you get this? This is easy money. Wow.
And you know what I'm thinking? Okay, I can set it up, apply for the contract, and then begin to hire people who are in that specialty.
Who are DJs.
So that way.
So I think I still might end up going after this contract, because we know DJs.
Right.
And we can just win the contract, and then we can subcontract it over to a DJ.
Right.
And now somebody has a job.
Right. Now that we're
looking for, this is a city a county government looking for a DJ for all of their events.
Yep.
Wow.
Contracts. Okay, this is some deep stuff right here. This is federal contracts. Y'all ain't ready for this. But I want to tell you about it so you can get ready.
That's right.
Okay, now Sam is the system for award management. If you are approved to become a federal contractor, you can do business across the country in any federal sector, as long as it's under the code that we call it NACES code, which is the code your business is registered under. So it took me 5 years to get registered and approved through SAM. And so now we are active. If we wanted to, we can go after some federal contracts. Right now, we just don't have the capacity. With federal contracts, they require a huge amount of data reporting back to them. And if you don't have someone that's actually in that capacity,
it's gonna be really, it's gonna be toy.
Y'all need me? Okay. Y'all need my card. I got it.
I mean, honestly, there are people who came to work with us when we were so small. Michelle's one of them. We were super small. Were you with us when we were in Marietta Square?
You know what? Not in Marietta Square.
Okay,
it's
so
been about 3 years, maybe.
I think you talked. Yeah, it's been about 4 or 5 years.
Wow.
So that she's able to
respect the exchange location.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so that's about 4 years. So that's a good amount of time. And some people just believe in the vision that God has given to us. We believe that our organization is supposed to be a national organization. Think about it like this. If the YMCA does what they do very well, the Boys and Girls Club do what they do very well, Opportunity Knocks do what we do very well. But we haven't had the opportunity to expand nationally until now. Until now. And the door has opened. But I know why God didn't open that door before. We weren't ready. We weren't ready. Because if we would have opened the door to expand 5 years ago,
it would have collapsed.
So do you mean, is there an expiration date? Because once you get approved as a government vendor,
do they require you
to be operating along that vein?
Every year.
You lose the money?
Every year it expires.
Okay, it expires. You have to re-up every year.
Yeah.
So this is strictly a license?
That's not a license. That's a contract.
It's a contract.
So basically the system, you're allowed to get into the system to get federal.
Right. So once you
register,
it gives you access to be able to bid for
contracts.
Right. I work for the federal government and I do look at contracts, but I have no contracts for the state programs.
Oh.
So, like you were saying, you have the percentage for Medicare and Medicaid services.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things we do is we oversee the state's children's health insurance program.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people think they can just go on the national endowment, and it's called called NEA for short, National Endowment for the Arts, and just apply. It is not that simple. It is not that simple. We would rather actually go through an NEA, get an NEA funding through Georgia, because we are specific. They know us there. And so when people review our proposal, it's not coming from a national view. A national view is like we're competing against. When you apply for Georgia Council for the Arts, we're competing against the Woodruff Arts Center, High Museum,
Boys and
Girls, Clubs. Right. We're competing. And we have, for the last 3 years, won the Georgia Council for the Arts. It took us. It took a long time. Every year we would get declined. We would have low scores. But I will always seek.
That's a good point.
I will always seek advice. So I would say, I would ask the judge, can you explain why you gave this particular score? And they would say, well, yeah, the description was a little vague. I didn't understand your program. It was too much going on. So I just started stripping it down. Say, okay, this is how we're going to do this. I'm going to do one program at a time. That's all I'm going to talk about. One program. Because the whole concept behind opportunity is that we provide multiple forms of multidisciplinary forms of arts to students in grades K through 12. And because we have so many different forms of arts that we deal with,
most people think that we're all over the place.
Right.
Because the model had not been done before to be a one-stop shop for all these. So they are like, well, how are you doing all these? We only get entries for
right. Think about like we have like
when it's correct.
That's right.
Georgia, what's the dance forum one?
Correct.
They
yeah,
only
right.
do dance.
Dance.
You know,
right.
the Dad's Garage, they only do dance.
They only do improv, right.
There are certain organizations that only do this. And they get awarded as well. So you don't have to be specializing in one area. You can specialize in multiple areas. But this, the fiscal sponsor, what I talked to you about earlier, we are a fiscal sponsor, so you don't have to be a nonprofit organization. If you see a grant that you believe fit your criteria, fit what you do specifically,
right.
and you believe that you have the opportunity to win that, then come to us and we can be your fiscal sponsor. Grant Station is a database of funders, and it's nationwide. Anybody who funds in the arts, or actually anybody who funds anything, and they submit a tax return for it, is on this list. It's in this database. They have thousands of funders. And our number one supporter, who have now almost, if this year they give us what I asked for, they would have supported us for $50,000, which is American Family Insurance, Dream Foundation. American Family Insurance is our number one supporter. Woohoo! And we never met them. That was only through grant writing, and that was through Grant Station. I found out about it through Grant Station. So that, I pay $100 a year for that, but honey, I didn't run that $100 a million times already.
So are you saying you go to what, GrantStation.com?
GrantStation.com.
Okay.
And it is a membership. It's a membership, annual subscription, I mean. Annual subscription. And it is about $129.
Individuals or businesses or?
Doesn't matter. Yeah, okay. It doesn't matter. It's $129, but it is worth it if you are actively seeking funding. And I use it every year. Is every year. Screencraft, however, is specifically for filmmakers. So those of you who are looking to screencraft. Whoo, it's a little warm in here. Maybe no.
Do you have some tissues?
Paper towel. So yeah, when you like work out a lot, then all of a sudden your body, your metabolism just starts speeding up for no reason. So that's what happened. So Screencraft specifically deals with filmmakers and writers, producers, and they fund up to $30,000.
You might need $30,000?
Yes.
And they can do it twice a year. Mm-hmm. Twice a year. So that's some good money right there.
You say they do what, twice a year?
Twice a year. They give out that money twice a year. Breakfast. Okay, here we go. All right. Yes. Oh. Well, it doesn't know. You can take a picture of this slide. This is a good resource. Just look up. So TechSoup will just give you a little overview. TechSoup is technology is donated by all the major players in the technology space. Microsoft, Dell, Adobe, they donate software to TechSoup. And TechSoup then say, nonprofits, you pay us a small admin fee and you can have access to this. So this is how I have Adobe Suites. And every time they get Adobe Suites, it sells out the same day. Because you can get Adobe Suites. Adobe Suites run for about $400 or $500. And TechSoup is $59.
For the whole suite.
For the whole suite. And that's why it goes like that. So I constantly look it on there for when they put new stuff on there. And they have laptops and they have some hardware ThinkPads and stuff on there, but I go on there specifically. Microsoft is $10. Mm-hmm. So every year we
whole Microsoft suite.
The Microsoft suite. Like Microsoft 2018 is what I have on my computer. And I pay for the whole download it on your computer, and it is now on your computer.
So it's not because okay, these are my confessions. I'm not usher, but up until about 3 or 4 years ago, I never paid for Microsoft because I always had love. Mm-hmm. But now I pay for it every month. They finally, you know, caught up.
Really?
Yeah, I pay for it every month. I've been trying to figure out a way around that.
But that's all it does.
How many years I got it for free? You know, it's
if you're working for a nonprofit, they can give
So y'all really need me, right?
Just go talk to me afterwards. Okay, y'all gonna talk about sponsorships. How many guys know what sponsors are? What's the purpose of sponsors are?
Give us money.
But what do they want in return?
Oh, they want the notoriety. They want the press. They want to look good. They want to feel like they're doing something for the community. Mm-hmm.
Well,
they want to be attached to their projects.
Well, y'all correct me, though, because, see, I always thought sponsors, don't they, like producers, don't they look for a return on their investment? That's what I always thought, though, too. I mean, if they're sponsoring, don't they want some of that back?
Yeah. So both of you are correct. So sponsors do look for a return on their investment, but they know that that might not necessarily come right away. The number one thing that they're looking for is access to a demographic. So they want access. If you are doing this huge event, let's say you have 2,000 people in expectation, well, they say, okay, now I'm getting visual, I'm getting before those 2,000 people with potential that I can then generate my funds from those participants.
Perfect example, our organization is the co-host of the largest back-to-school event for the state of Georgia. We co-hosted with Atlanta Public School District, and we are responsible for securing the sponsors for the kids' zones and all the other zones that's not related to a school-related event, a school-related vendor. And so what we have to do is we're massaging sponsors. We're telling them, okay, what is it that you want to get out of this? There is a 15,000 footprint at this event.
15,000 people in attendance.
Right. So that makes, for starters, everybody eyes looked up.
Well, you said how many?
15,000. So I'll tell you about the conversation that I'm having with one sponsor right now. Well, I'll tell you about the one I just closed. So Samsung is now signed on as an official sponsor for the event. And one of the things I said, what do you want to get out of this? They said, well, we need data. We need people to do surveys. So if there's some way they can sell, what we'll do is we'll set up stations where in order to enter into, we call it the calm zone. So parents will have an opportunity to come into the calm zone. They can charge their phones. We're going to have nice little couches and lounges, little music playing over there. And they can relax while their kids are over there in inflatables going wild and crazy. And this is all happening and we'll set up some stations so that they can only enter the zone unless they do the survey. She's like, really? I said, yes, we'll do that for you. And now it's a win-win.
Right. And so a lot of times with sponsors is that we look at them like, give me money.
Right.
I know you got it. Your pocket's deep, right? But we don't approach them as to
what can I do for you
out of the situation. Because right. We'll gladly give up some space if you're going to provide the actual funding for the actual area, right? You have to find out what they need. Many times I see so many people miss out on sponsorship dollars for the simple fact that they don't ask what you need.
So with any sponsorship, you need a professional looking deck.
What's a deck?
We call it a deck in the sponsorship world, but you might call it like just a proposal or sponsorship packet. Mm-hmm. So that is essentially what you send to sponsors that have the different levels of sponsorships on it and what they get for that level.
Right.
But it needs to look clean. It needs to look professional. And if you can't find a graphic designer to do it for you, go to Fiverr.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
So you need to make sure it has visuals. All my writers over there, don't overwrite your content in your deck. Put images in there. We're in the digital era. Most people are on social media. You only have them for a moment of time. You don't just hit the facts and show the information. Yes.
So with the sponsorship, is this corporate sponsor?
Yes,
corporate sponsor, like
small businesses.
Okay, so what amount should you start asking for? Because I was told, do not come up in and ask nobody for $500 or $1,000 when they're corporate people with money. What is the...
So that question is so weighted.
Yeah.
let me say it like this. $500 on a corporate level is doable, but you need to make sure that what you have in your value is worth the $500 that they're going to actually give. So now we're at a point where we're asking for larger sums.
Our top tier for the event that's in August is
$50,000.
Right. So our bottom tier is $5,000. So they can't even talk to me if they don't have $5,000 to bring to the table.
Right. So what that also means that we have to make sure our leg room in preparation is available. Because a lot of times with sponsorships, corporations already earmark who they're going to give funds to at a certain time of the year. So if you're coming and you're saying, hey, I need this amount, they're going to say...
And then it's 3 weeks away?
No, it's not going to happen.
Probably not.
It's not going to happen.
That was my other question. So what's the date? Is there a window of time?
Yes. So 6 weeks is the very last... And I say that is just pushing it. So 6 weeks is the baseline. If that's how much you have, you have less than 6 weeks, then don't even go after a corporation. You can go after a smaller business. A business maybe like a Mexican food restaurant where the owner actually, works in the restaurant. Things like that you can probably go after. But corporations like Target or Microsoft, that's not enough time.
Right.
So we always say...
Unless you're looking for smaller dollar amounts, for example, you might can go to Target and you might can get gift cards. Most Targets individually have a...
Well, you have to be a nonprofit to get gift cards.
Well, yes, but it's easy to connect with.
If you're under a fiscal sponsor, yes. So you may be able to do the legwork for the nonprofit, say, hey, I'm a nonprofit, we have an event coming up, and all we need is 4 gift cards of $25 each, and they will do it for you. They will do it for the organization.
Is there an industry standard, sponsorship?
To answer the other part, 9 months.
9 months.
9 months is the I would recommend. Nine months to a year away, that's when you start looking for sponsors. Like, for example, we are now 6 months away from our event. I'm already under a lot of pressure to try to get these sponsors in.
Absolutely.
Because I feel like I'm behind the eight ball.
I've heard that with the businesses and big corporations and stuff, they allot a certain amount every year.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Do you happen to know what time of year they do it in January?
Yes. So you want to look, you want to start attacking this corporation. Attacking. Go ahead. Attack!
Approaching.
Approaching. October, November, December for the next fiscal year. Most of them have their fiscal year start in January, February, or March. Walmart starts February 1st. So guess what? I've already started asking them for money. Walmart, Sam's Club, they're owned by the same, you know, they're the same. So
TJ Maxx.
TJ Maxx, and they're a family of companies. Mm-hmm. TJ Maxx companies. Mm-hmm. All of those companies are January, February, March. But if you start asking after that, I don't think there's any company where their fiscal year is in the middle of the year. Mm-hmm. But if you're going to them in the summertime, they'll say, well, we'll put you in consideration for next year.
Right.
But if your event is in the summertime, you should have started last year in the fall.
Yep. Yeah. Which last also means you have to plan further along. You can't come up with an idea and say, hey, well, we're going to do this next week.
Wow. Yeah.
Did you give yourself enough time
to
get the funds that you need?
So yeah. October, November 2019 would have been for 2021.
October, November, December 2019 would have been great if we had a summer event for this year. Summer, fall event for this year.
Okay.
Now, once you get to about April, May, June, they're already exhausted their funds. They have a certain amount that they can allocate for events. And the only way that they could end up having money left over is if the amount that they were allocating to spend didn't go through, either maybe the event was canceled or something like that. And so they may have some funds that's lingering for in the middle of the year.
Yeah.
But that's an anomaly, and so I wouldn't depend on that.
So
but
right now they're giving me some funds.
I was going to say, y'all
are
going to get canceled.
There are funds available right now.
Yes.
That's
this is the perfect time. I spend January, February, March, and parts of April grant writing and going after sponsors. All of my money is made this first 4 months of the year. And then I'm posting for the rest of the year. And then November, December is my end of year campaign. So that's when I start going after that end of year. They call it, so you know you have Black Friday.
Mm-hmm.
Black Friday, you know where that came from, right? Some of you that, okay.
Yeah,
so, you know, the business is
going
to be leaving, going up into Black Friday. And the Black Friday is the date that most of them go into the black, and it's the beginning of the Christmas shopping season, which the majority of retail, some of them make more than 50% of their revenue during that short period of time, because we are over consumers, over spenders when it comes to the holidays.
Yeah, and you also with the sponsorships, I want to make sure you remember to give yourself some lead time, because there is still a process for once you are approved, when you're going to actually disperse those funds.
Yep. So sometimes it can be up to 6 weeks, to 8 weeks before you actually see the check in your hand.
Correct.
When you're dealing with these major corporations. So if you really, really need the funding, I would start with the smaller businesses that's surrounding your event.
Okay.
Like for example, if you're doing a 5K for your film event. Well, if the 5K is in Old Fort Ward or a certain part of Atlanta that has a particular network and region, you want to make sure that those businesses that surrounding that event has a presence at your event, because that means that these people are going to be in the area and they want to know what businesses are in that area. And that will make me as a business owner sponsor your event. Now I might not pay $500 unless your event is in its third, fourth year and you have demonstrated success.
Which is another good thing.
Yeah.
You know, I just have a suggestion. You were talking about like Old Fort Ward and you know these little neighborhoods in Atlanta. They all have small business councils, they all have these local organizations.
Mm-hmm.
So just find out where they're meeting and stuff like that. And that's a good way to get all of them together.
Yes. Yes, I'm a member of Atlanta Black Chamber, COG Collaborative. There's just a network of, you want to join associations anyway, and that's not on here, but you want to join associations, anything that's related to your field. Whatever association you can join. Doesn't have to be pertinent to your race, it can be open as well.
Right.
I'm a part of Atlanta Black Chamber, but I'm also a part of Chamber of Commerce. So it's a two totally different looks.
Right. And so also in connection to sponsors, so also remember you are a business, you as an entrepreneur, you're a small business.
You.
Right, exactly. Because you are the brand. So just because you start small, just remember, don't think small. Right? So So in that process, remember, even if they're looking for longevity too. So if you're thinking about getting larger funds and this is your first year, they're probably not going to give it to you because you have not shown enough proof of concept.
Right, right. So you want to make sure that you, if you want to determine how much you should ask for, start with your event budget. What's your event budget? Is it going to cost $3,000 to put this event on? Well, then you need to find 6 sponsors that will do $500 or 10 sponsors that will do $250. Mm-hmm. Whichever one that will, because you want your event covered. You don't want it coming out of your pocket at the end of the day. So we're going to move on to crowdfunding. So a lot of us know about GoFundMe. That is the number one crowdfunding website in the world. And if I see another GoFundMe page. But it is what it is. It's worth billions of dollars and it works. It works. But there are crowdfunding websites that are specifically for creatives. Number one is Kickstarter. I'm pretty sure many of you have heard of it. But Kickstarter is a way that other investors go on. You don't know this, but other investors go on Kickstarter and look for projects to fund. You may get a random donation on here. I do sometimes. Go Get Funding is another one. It's just like Kickstarter. This one focuses on creative industry. And then Indiegogo. It's more small independent projects. It's more project based. So if you are doing a golf tournament, that's not going to work for you. That platform is not going to work for you. Okay? But these three are the three that I recommend. There are dozens of crowdfunding sources. Yep. But I also like these three because other investors know about these platforms and they go looking for projects. So you could have a project on there and it gets somebody's attention. They're like, oh, this seems interesting. And when you do one of these projects, you want to have clean video, photos. If you're a musician,
well-written content.
Right, very well-written content. If you're a musician, you should have some audio of your work. If anything, I would prefer a video of your work. If you are a filmmaker, you should have some clips. Highlight reel. My son is a football player, and he had to put together a highlight reel of his entire football career from 9th to 12th grade for these recruiters. And the highlight reel had to be 60 seconds. I was like, how do you do that? Well, he did it. He figured it out. But that's how long your highlight reel should be.
So put don't make it too long. Don't make it 10 minutes.
60 seconds. You lost them after that.
Maximum 2 minutes.
That's
exactly.
Thank you.
So most people think
60 seconds, right?
60 seconds to 2 minutes, longer. Yeah, if it's too long, you're gonna check out.
Yeah. You want people to be engaged with the video, and so the best content should be within the first 15 to 30 seconds, and then you can, once you, what we call the eye catcher. Once you put that eye catcher out there, then,
think of it like a sandwich.
Well, yeah, actors.
You got the bread, the meat, and then more
that's
bread.
Right, because they can give it the 1 minute monologues, everything under 1 minute. I mean, you know, actors will have to get used to that.
Yes.
So, I'd like to add another creative website for people just to investigate. Seed and Spark.
What is it called?
Seed and Spark.
Seed and Spark?
Seed, like planting seeds and Spark.
Seed and Spark.
Seed and Spark, yeah.
Thank you for that.
And they do a lot of educational workshops so that before you actually launch a crowdfunding campaign, you kind of know what you're getting into. They provide guidance. They've done a couple of creative workshops here in the Atlanta area, but they travel all around the country doing, and they're free. That's the other thing. They do free workshops.
Free workshops.
For their crowdfunding campaign.
Oh, that's wonderful. See, it's work.
Love free resources.
Okay, the last thing we're going to talk about is foundations and fellowships. So many of you have already gone to college for your craft, but if you haven't and you feel like there is a way for you to learn more, and fellowships don't necessarily have to be for college students, but it's like 50-50. So some fellowships are just specifically for the creative that wants to do this full time, but just doesn't have the resources to do it. And so they actually, most fellowships pay a stipend to be a part of it. Once you are accepted into the fellowship, then they will pay you a monthly or bi-weekly stipend to be in it. And then you're undergoing additional training. They put you into some opportunities for you to present your craft, and then there's a graduation of it. So a fellowship, I started with fellowship first because that is the easiest one to talk about before we go to foundations. Now, foundations are another form of grant giving, but foundations are usually people or families who are giving to this particular industry. So that might be like the Awesome Foundation. The Awesome Foundation is a family who are serious about investing in arts and entertainment. And so they give $1,000 at a time. They do it probably about 100 times a year. But it's good startup seed money. The McKnight Fellowship, so we're talking about fellowship, back to fellowship. This is a fellowship that is $30,000, and it will allow you to work in your craft in film and television. So if that's one you want to go into, definitely McKnight. And then for a list of more fellowships, you pull out your phone, you can hit the camera button on your screen, and it should scan that QR code, and it'll go right to the website.
It doesn't matter if you have Apple or Android.
Right. You should be able to zoom into it. Did it come up for you guys?
And you said this is only for film and...
No. The fellowship, for this, the fellowship, this is all in arts and entertainment. But McKnight is, yes, film.
I am a creative as well, so if you need music,
So I played the character that Loretta Devine played. Okay. So so I did acting for a long time throughout high school. It was probably the arts is what kept me in high school. I can tell you that. But and then I did sing when I was in school as well. So they would call me a triple threat because I danced as well. All
right.
So today I make sure that the money is there for others to do.
So I
have a very important role.
That's right. That's right.
Really do. And so I also created something that's called the Entrepreneurship Institute. Its focus is art, business, entertainment, and technology. And that actually is a tool where we would actually be hosting workshops. We've been hosting workshops, and I bring in people from the industry to also educate, as I call it, on demand. But in the process, we also have training so people can get certifications to be able to provide services to corporations and even in film. So a lot of times, you know, here Atlanta's the new Hollywood, right? But unfortunately, we have a lot of people from Hollywood come in, shoot the film. And
they bring all their people in from LA.
Right.
Everybody come in.
And then you go back, right? But they also take our tax break, right?
Mm-hmm. They take our tax break, and they go right back to California.
Yeah, so part of my heart, too, is to be able to train people up in these various industries so that we can keep the revenue right there in Georgia.
That's good.
Yes.
I have a question.
Yes.
You were saying do our proposal to make sure. So is there any, because I met a lady and, you know, she, that's what she does. She does this sponsorship thing, you know, all the way around. Like her first sponsorship for her little event was $100,000 from corporate people. And so she horns in all the, she always talk about industry standard and industry standard proposal that you can present to get what you need, your money or for the corporate. Do y'all have like a template or something?
Here's the thing, now, something called Google, right? Google has these awesome templates.
Okay.
You don't have to recreate the wheel. It's readily available.
Okay.
Your focus is your content because that is proprietary.
Your content and your images.
Yep, that's proprietary to you. Nobody can put that in there.
Okay.
Right.
Template, that's the easy part.
Right. There are industry standards.
What's too much?
Well, ours is about 8 to 10 pages.
10 pages.
Oh, okay.
Yes, ours is about 8 to 10 pages.
Now, in that 10 pages, don't have a lot of words. You
no,
lose people.
It's just little bullets.
Bullet points, yeah, exactly. Okay. You want a bullet point. All you're doing is gathering interest first.
Well, remember, you want to have a page for each sponsorship level. You don't want to have all the sponsorship levels on the same page because
okay.
It can be confusing. So you have to have about us, something about you, what
right.
you do, and things like that, about the event, and then your sponsorship level.
Right. What's
don't
the purpose
that
for
one.
The event?
Right.
What's the purpose for the event?
Right.
It can't be just you want to make money, right? There has to be something that's going to connect people. I mean, of course, at the end of the day, that's what you're trying to do, but it cannot look like my purpose is just to make money.
Right.
Because if you're building a relationship, ideally, you want that sponsor to support when you do it again.
Right.
Right.
So we have ongoing sponsors. I don't think we have any sponsors that haven't come back 2 years in a row. And that's because it is really about relationships. It's not just about the content and the deck or how nice and pretty the industry proposal will look. It may get you your foot in the door, but then once you start communicating with the person who will be writing the check, that's the relationship that you need to build. That's when you go on their LinkedIn page, find out what schools they went to, find out how many kids they got. These are conversations that you have with them, when, especially if you're female, because we're very relational. And remember, even though I'm an executive, what am I first? A wife, a mom. So the executive is like fourth. I'm a child of God, I'm a wife, I'm a mom, I'm an executive. That's the order. So if someone comes to me and asks me, oh, I see you have a son in high school in football. What I have?
Right. And so a lot of times we look at and we say, it's who you know. But it's really who knows you.
Yeah.
Right? You have to
speaking to her at the such and such event. Oh, now you repeat their, I think I might just approve this. Okay. We literally, the contract that we had last year for $80,000, we literally got that relationship because he was sitting on the board for a school.
Yep.
And he became friends with the principal.
She kept telling me, she said, she's like, ask them when we can get it. I said, nope, not the time yet.
I'm like, we want that contract. Ask them if we can get the contract.
It's like,
he's
nope.
Like, not yet. 3 years he was on the board. He didn't ask them for anything.
Nope,
he just was there to help. Was there to help. The third year is when they said, you know what, we need to find an enrichment provider. He said, well.
No, you don't.
Now he got his hand up. Well, I can help you with that. Really?
Yeah.
He just sent in information. Which he called me and said, Ty, I need you to send over a quote and a description of what they want to do.
They said, how fast can you get it to me? I said, oh, give me a couple hours.
Well, it's easy because it's something that I'm already.
I have
created. Right. It's not something I'm creating because I do all the grant writing. So all I do is copy and paste from other grants that I had and just put it together in one document and send it over. And they were like, oh, okay, we can do this. We can do this. All right.
Which also says that sometimes your relationships might take a while. You know, you can't just go up to somebody and say, hey, give me your $20, right? What you need $20 for? What you trying to buy? You know, wait, I don't really know you like that. You ask me for money? That's what they're feeling like.
Right. Right? Like, you don't know me. You just going to come up to me and ask me for $500.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like, who does that? But that's what we do all the time when we're looking at, when we're going after sponsorships, when we're going after these dollars, we're going after, remember, you're not contacting a company. There is a person, one person, or maybe two in that department that's behind that button that's going to say approved. That's the person you need to get to know. And what I do before I apply for anything, I go on the website of the company. I go and find who are in those key positions. I go on their LinkedIn page. I find out what colleges they went to. I find out everything I can know about that person before I apply. And I put all of those keywords in my application or in my proposal. Just like when you think about it, when you apply for a job, are you going to submit the same resume to all these different jobs? Hopefully you're not. Hopefully you are tailoring that resume for every single job you apply. And it is something that most people do not do as an executive president. Listen here, online folks. If you are not changing your resume for every single job you apply to, that's why you don't have the job. Because when I get a resume, I'm looking at what your cover letter say. Oh, it says, I will love the opportunity to work for your company. This will be a great opportunity. Thank you. I'm like, there's no specialization, there's no personalization. This is obviously a template. Okay, then I get to your resume. It says, TJ Maxx, retail associate, actor, for this, all these different, and then actor. Then the next job is the Home Depot. I'm like, what? Why do I have all this other stuff? Just give me the acting resume because that's the position you're applying for.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I don't need to know you worked at the Home Depot.
Yeah, so the same thing applies. And keep in mind, you're going to have to probably do research about that company that you're asking because maybe your project just doesn't fit in their mission.
That's right.
Right? So sometimes you have to have a note. Same thing with acting. It's because you don't fit in the role. Just because you don't fit the role for this. It has nothing to do with you personally.
Right.
It's just you don't fit for what we're currently looking for.
Right. So many people take that seriously in the entertainment world. Be like, well, I don't understand why I don't get this role. Well, honestly, this is just not a good fit for you. But doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with you. It just means that this role is not a good fit. But there are some roles that are a good fit for you.
Also, just adding to that too, that I think that a lot of times when it comes to actors or even people within the industry, what they're applying for, they're not the only ones. I mean, there are tons of submissions, you know, for a particular project, whether it's to perform or to work as a crew. I had a gentleman to contact me the other day because he has a client who is international like, well, you're probably one of many who has applied for a cool job. So I just, you know, continue to encourage him that you're not going to go and get the first job you submit to. It's going to be probably multiple submissions before you even get that one call back.
Right, multiple submissions. And let me tell you, it still boils down to relationship.
Yeah.
Because I probably, now I try not to hire too many people that I know because familiarity can get in the way, and it has gotten in the way in the past, but I tend to do very well now because we keep the lines clear. But when I know you and I know your character, or I know of you and someone can vouch for your character, I would rather give you the job, even though your resume may not line up as closely, than I would who somebody whose resume has all the bells and whistles. I don't know anything about them or their character or their dependability. And I have had people who have applied to work for me who, oh my goodness, they had all the bells and whistles on their resume, but was the worst employee that I ever had.
Wow.
And have gotten fired.
Did you get your question answered? What's your question?
You all mentioned that you had a podcast, but you didn't say what the name of it was.
Oh, Love and Entrepreneurship.
Love and Entrepreneurship.
So that's right
there.
That's the name of it. So, I mean, facebook.com/
Love and Entrepreneurship.
With the ampersand or with the A and D?
It's with
A and D.
A and D,
okay.
On
yep. And you can go to loveandentrepreneurship.com, catch up on the last of the latest episodes, the previous episodes, definitely. And we have this episode.
And all of our events are posted on the website as well, loveandentrepreneurship.com.
Mm-hmm. And it's only a video podcast and an audio that's available on different audio on.
Yep, so, yeah, good question. So, be on the lookout next month. I'll post it and let you guys know. But it will be on, the audio will be on all major streaming. It's a podcast. Yep.
So Chris mentioned that he wrote a book earlier this year called The Compact Guide to Creating Multiple Streams of Income. It's a wonderful book. The book is only 10 pages. You want to know why? Because he knows that you guys are on social media and it only takes a little bit of time before you get distracted.
How many people have picked up a book and said, ooh, I'm
you get not chapter one.
Okay, you got the chapter two, and you got
the
woo! I checked out, right?
You checked out.
So I'm going right to the meat. It's the compact guide.
Right.
Yep, so
I'm since he knows you're only going to read chapter one and two, that's where he stops. One and two.
Yep, so since you're here, I'm going to give you a direct link so you can download it for free. There's also an area where if you want to give a tip, if you felt like you got anything out of today, go ahead and send a tip. If not, then just go ahead and download it. Make it as a resource. I guarantee you will make money if you just apply what's in this book.
So, quick question. Is there any events or projects that anyone is working on right now that they're raising money for right now?
Yes.
What is it?
Yes. Well, even in reference to the play, we like to tour, do some touring dates in the summer. So what are our chances right now?
So that was just on the dates and locations?
No, but Macon but not
so
confirming the venues and confirming the locations. Correct.
Okay.
Correct. So but that's a great question. So should we really, you know, as producers and directors and everything, should we go ahead and because you want to have the details and specifics in place. So go
you're
ahead
not
going to
be
sure
a sponsor on my idea.
No. They're going to need to know that this is going on.
Right.
Like for us, like where's the location going?
If I'm asking for $50,000, if I'm asking for $50,000, it better not be at somebody's house.
That's right. That's right. Exactly.
If you're gonna, they're gonna look at they first thing they ask me, what's your venue? Is the venue booked?
That's right.
I say yes, it is. It's at the Georgia World Congress Center.
Georgia World Congress
Center. Oh, well. Well, that we know about that space.
And we have Paul.
Yeah.
And we have Paul C1 and C2.
That's
Oh, oh. Now you've been to the Georgia World Conference Center. You know how large just one hall is. Right. So we have two halls. So
and it's packed with all 30,000 of those people too. 25,000 of those kids running all around.
Yeah,
like,
mom, come on.
So here's my suggestion. You definitely book it. Have your location. Sometimes you are going to have to walk on the water. Know how much your budget is, though, because that's how much you're going to ask for. You might have to break it down into smaller chunks. Maybe you get somebody to sponsor just this particular event.
You know what? I learned that from
And then go to the next tour and get somebody to sponsorship this instead of the whole tour.
That's good. I learned that a long time ago from Pastor Gregory when I was in the Bible training center. Shameless plug. This is why I love this church. You know, even though I'm not a member, I am a huge supporter of everything Pastor Gregory does. And he told us this when I was in school. He said, it is not hard for you to raise $1,000.
How do you do it, Pat?
10 people can give you $100.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Can you get
10
people
to give you $100? And I was like, don't know 10 people who have $100. I said, no, I'm
going
to have to
break that
a little bit more. I think I can get $50 from 20 people.
So you're breaking it down.
Or maybe I can get $20 from 50 people.
Yeah.
Now, I think I can get $20 from 50 people. Do you think you can get... So tell me about your event.
The Television Expo is in July.
So it's set. Mm-hmm. What is it called?
The Talent Vision Expo.
Talent Vision Expo. Mm-hmm. And what is your event about?
It is basically where we bring talents from different states, and they showcase their talent. And then we also have people like Lamar. We have summer rooms this year where they're going to be teaching on different phases of the industry. So it could be voice acting. We have a lady that's over the beauty industry. We have that encompasses anybody in the beauty world. So it's about connecting the dots of the puzzle of entertainment.
So what's your bottom level sponsor? The lowest sponsor?
$1,000.
And what's the highest sponsor?
$5,000.
Okay, so have you gotten any sponsors so far?
Sent out the letters about 4 months ago, so.
How's your follow up?
It's going pretty good. Like, yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do $1,000. I'm going to do $100. And then a few of the people that has done it before. But
is this the first year?
Mm-hmm. No, this is my fourth year.
The fourth year? Okay. Did you have sponsors last year?
I didn't do it last year.
Okay, so the last time you did the event, did you have sponsors?
Yeah, we had a few, but it wasn't
like smaller sponsors?
Yeah.
And do you have vendor opportunities?
Yes.
Vendor table opportunities?
Yes.
And how much is your vendor table opportunity?
They're $250.
$250 for a vendor table.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so, and how many people is expected to attend this event?
This year, 250.
Okay, so as a sponsor of events, I would not sponsor. Not at that price point.
Okay.
But I will come in at a more affordable price point for that number of people. For that number of people, I will probably come in at
$100. Okay, that's cool. Okay.
Because, see, there are so many events.
It is.
In the city of Atlanta.
It is.
That, and everybody's coming to us to sponsor an event, right? And they want us to do a workshop, and they want us to be everything to everybody. There's only so much you can do, and there's only so many events you can be a part of.
Right.
So we have to select the one that we feel is going to give us the most visibility.
And so here's a pivot. You might want to focus on your vendors right now.
Vendors.
Until you increase your attendance for the event.
Okay.
Then you can start looking for sponsors.
Right.
Okay.
Because I can tell you that the next time we go after this, this is something that I would love to talk to you about more offline.
Okay.
But the more you go after vendors, have some quality vendors.
Okay.
Not just, you know, Shaniqua who do the hair in the basement. But I'm talking about quality vendors. These are reputable companies or nonprofit organizations or reputable even celebrities who have businesses.
Okay.
And then you establish a nice vendor role.
Okay.
That's what it's called, vendor role. Make it affordable for those companies that want to be a part of it. This is their first time hearing about it, and then you can go up on the price next year.
Okay.
But then after this year, then you can say, these are the companies. You don't have to say that they were vendors.
Okay.
Correct.
These are the companies that were a part of the event last year.
Okay. Correct.
And, I mean, we had, now, our vendor list is huge now.
Right.
You got Mercedes-Benz, Delta, Waffle House at this particular event that I'm talking about. So this particular event, it took some time to get to that.
Okay.
Took some time to get to that. But it just started off with just being Meals on Wheels organization.
Right.
But people know these names. They know about these organizations.
Right.
They know about these businesses. They're smaller, but they are here in the local community, and people will support it.
Yeah, so we are 10. We are 10.
So we're a little bit over.
I want to do one more thing.
Okay. Well, she did.
She did say she had she had her hand up first.
Yeah, I'm good. My event is not. So it's an event. It's not. We don't even have a date yet. It's going to be next year. It's a short film showcase. We did
a short
film showcase.
Short film showcase.
So we did it 2 years in a row. It was a free event, packed out, great entries. We, and I say we, it's my sorority. We are looking and investigating doing it as a fundraiser because it has been so great to see. We've had some recognizable names and organizations to be a part of it the first year. We had the CAF Entertainment Commission's executive director on our talkback panel. We had some, you know, well-known filmmakers who have, you know, received awards, casting directors, all that. So we're still definitely in the planning stage, but looking at how we can develop that into a fundraiser, knowing that we're going to need sponsors, perhaps vendors. And as you were talking to Rose about her event, it made me think about, you mentioned like maybe celebrity vendors. We might even give some of those people vendors.
Correct.
Just so we get a celebrity attachment and brand attachment to our event, so that the next year, 2022, when we come back and we look at some larger sponsors, we can say, you know,
such was a part of our event.
Yeah.
So you will be able to secure a vendor booth before you're able to secure a sponsor. Here's the levels. The vendor booths, they don't have to send their top executives.
Right.
They can send, you know, there's a sales associate or a customer service rep to manage the booth. They want to just have presence at the event. That vendor booth is a little bit more affordable. They want to test it out.
Okay.
They want to try it out.
Remember.
And then next year, when they find out how much success they can get from that event, next year I'm going to be a sponsor.
Okay.
Right. So remember, your sponsorship dollars have to be able to be relevant to the amount of support that's actually going to be at the event.
Okay.
Right? So you can't ask for $5,000 and it's going to be 100 people.
Gotcha.
They're not going to see any value in that.
Okay. Thank you.
So events are one of the number one ways that people use to raise funds for indie projects. Indie projects. So if you think about your project, think about the type of project it is, if you can use your talent to be the fundraiser. If not, then it may be like, you know, some people do 5Ks, golf tournaments, whatever. Whatever your network, where you feel like they will come and pay for, like she has this built-in event, that is something that people will pay for. But you have to understand that there's going to be a cost in the beginning that may be on you. But as you build it, they will come.
Yes.
And that's our time. But before I go, I have something that I want to share with y'all. Before I left the house, God told me, I want you to do something before you end this workshop. I'm like, okay. I already know where this is going. So I told him, he already know when I get in that mood, don't even bother.
I'm bothered anyway.
He said there will be someone here who has an event that could use some sponsoring. And I want you to sponsor their event. I said, sponsor? That'd be a vendor. Just support it. So that person is you.
Oh,
so
wow.
Come on up. I will be sewing a senior to your event, $100.
Thank you, Jesus.
So if they need to come to one of our workshops,
There's hand sanitizer out there, so don't worry. But hey, but let's give Ty and Chris another hand. Thank y'all so much for coming out. I mean, it really took me. Give your contact information, like your socials and all that stuff.
Yeah, definitely. And I urge everybody, connect with the people that's in the room. You don't, if you don't know everybody, make sure you give out your other social. You can follow me on your Facebooker. My name is Chris Alphalox Woods on Facebook. Follow me there. Make sure you follow Love and Entrepreneurship.
Chris Alphalox.
Yeah, Alphalox. Also, my Instagram, all the social media is Alpha Knox. Like I said, I'm a music producer, but I'm also an entrepreneur. So definitely follow me on Instagram.
Follow me on Instagram at Mrs. Ty Woods, MRS, TYWOODS, Mrs. Ty Woods, and all of the platforms that he just stated as well. And at Opportunity Knox, ARTPORTUNITY, Opportunity Knox. There.
Cool. Opportunity Knox, thank you very much for coming out. We are this is pretty much the end of our meeting for today, but we'll be meeting again second Saturday of every month. So we're going to have stuff like this all the time. We're going to have, you know, a lot of fun. We're going to have, you know, times we can come up and just do workshops, and we can share monologues, share tips and tricks and advice with each other, encourage each other. And, you know, sometimes we can get together and let's say, hey, Angela has a play, or let's say Michelle's got an event, let's say Tina's got something, let's say any of you have anything, we can get together and go and check them out, you know, and have our meeting there. You know, we can always get in a word as well, you know, beforehand, or at least, you know, come together and pray that for their event and the success of their event as well. Amen. So we got to get out of here at 2 p.m. They said they're closing the building at 2, but I appreciate y'all coming out. Thank you so much. Anybody wants to get in touch with me, I'm at Lamar Gully with 2 R's on all the socials. And I'm at Lamar Gully, V-O. V is in victory, O is in O as well. So if y'all need to get in touch with me or connect with me online, feel free to do that as well, all right? All right, God bless y'all. Thank y'all for coming out. Thanks, Michelle, for lining up the event as well.
All right. And for all my love and entrepreneurship guests, thank you for watching. Until next time.
Okay.